Okay, I'm going to start the recording. Hi, everybody. Some of you, most of you probably know me, but my name is Carol Goldberg, and I am pleased today to present Rabbi Moshe Bloom from the Machon HaTorah Va'eretz Institute. He told me he was a shaliach in Poland and a community rabbi there, and he heads the English department of this institute. I do want to say that this shiur is being dedicated to my mother, Mantze Zissel Bat Chaitzi, Zechorna Levracha. She passed away in February at the age of 91. She had the zchut to see many children, and not children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren live in Israel. And I think this shiur on how to take care of the land is most appropriate. Rabbi Bloom, I turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you. I was born in Israel, Moshe Bloom, in Kibbutz Maale Gilboa, up north. My father is from Pittsburgh, my mother from Brooklyn, New York. They were in Bnei Akiva, made Aliyah, 1979. I was born here. And after finishing Smicha in the Hesder Yeshiva in Yerucham, I went through Machon Amiel, if some of you heard, and Torah Mitzion, and I was a shaliach Rosh Kollel in Warsaw, in Poland, for 4 years. And I was assisting the chief rabbi there, Rav Shudrich, and a community rabbi. And 3 years ago, we came back. We live in Petach Tikva, and I'm working in a Torah Ve'aretz Institute, Machon HaTorah Ve'aretz, as an English department, and giving lectures and tours. I don't know, tours you can say today, Zichrono Livracha, I think. The last two we had was before Purim, but Bezrat Hashem, we'll go back to it sometime. I wanted today to talk about Terumot and Maaserot, and two things are important. One is, I guess, I assume most of you know how to do a Hafrashat Terumot and Maaserot. What I want to do in the first half of the lecture is to learn it, to make sure we all fully understand the text and what's behind it, not only what to say and what to do, but to understand deeper what exactly we're supposed to do. And the second half, we'll talk about all kinds of situations, herbs in the house, outside the house. If you see in the city, you see palm trees and you want to take the dates and all kinds of situations that are more specific. If we have, you can stop me with questions, you can send on the chat, as you wish. You're supposed to be able to unmute yourself. Any questions before we start? I guess that's a no, so we're starting. Okay, Terumot and Maaserot. Okay, Rabbi Shimlai taught, the Gemara in Sota. For what reason did Moshe, our teacher, greatly desire to enter the land of Israel? This is what Moshe said. Many mitzvot were commanded to the Jewish people, and many of them can be fulfilled only in the land of Israel. So I will enter the land so that I can fulfill all of them. According to the Gemara in Sota, Moshe wanted to enter the land of Israel in order that he can fulfill all of the mitzvot. We have about 50 mitzvot atluyot ba'aretz that are connected to the land of Israel. And Moshe, according to the Midrash, wanted to go to Eretz Israel in order to fulfill these mitzvot. And as my father said 40 years ago, when he came on Aliyah, he studied in YU 6 years. And he said, listen, Moshe, I came to Kibbutz Maale Gilboa, Israel. I had to learn this from scratch. You know, I learned Mishnayot Zraim. I knew what Terumot Maaserot are, but how to do it practically and with all the details, I never learned, and he had to learn. And it's something that we need to understand. It's a topic, just like Shabbat, we understand we have to learn it. We know the basics, but we have to learn the details. Same for Terumot and Maaserot. Same for Mitzvot Liyot Baretz. and Terumot and Maaserot. Generally, the mitzvot that tluyot ba'aretz are practical, orla and neta revai, very practical, whoever has trees, kil'ayim, which are, there are three kinds, kile zra'im, kile akerem, and kile ilan, grafting of trees, Terumot and Maaserot, shmita, which will be next year. A lot what they talk about shmita, but it's not our topic today. Matanot anim, presents for the poor, leket shichecha pe'ah, peretz ve'olelot. Not so practically, we don't fulfill this mitzvah today. Mitzvat chadash, mitzvat chala, which is a mitzvah tluya ba'aretz, but applies also in chutz la'aretz. And we have two other topics that are not exactly more animals, tzar ba'alei chayim, cruelty animals, and laws of raising sheep, that also our institute is dealing with. We have a rabbi whose specialty is animals, so that's why it's here in the presentation. There are some mitzvot that apply also outside of Israel, and not so important for now to know, but Orla, let's say, applies b'chutz la'aretz as well. Not many people know that. Terumot and Maaserot, if you see in chutz la'aretz, you get oranges from Israel, so usually they are not, nobody took Terumot and Maaserot, and you should do it. Kilei Akerem as well, Kilei Ilan as well, other things, but less important for us. Okay, this I will need your help, whoever can answer. How many mitzvot involve Terumot and Maaserot? Out of Taryag mitzvot, how many are Terumot and Maaserot? I'll give you a hint, between 3 and 50. Let's see who has a guess. Just open yourself and say. It's only guessing, unless you learned it.
My husband says 14.
Good. It's 20 mitzvot, very close. 6 positive mitzvot aser, and 14 negative mitzvot lot aser are included in Terumot and Maaserot, meaning a person that does it as he should, he fulfills 20 mitzvot out of the 613. It's a big thing. And if you do it every week, because you pick every week a few fruit and vegetables, so every time you are dealing with 20 mitzvot, it's a big thing. Okay, let's talk. When we talk about Terumot and Maaserot, there are two different things, two different levels. The first level of Hafrashat Terumot and Maaserot is separating and naming, meaning to take the produce and to say, this Terumah Gdola, this Maaser Rishon, this Terumat Maaser, etc., and specifying them, separating them, and naming them. Once you did that, the produce is no longer tevel. Now, there's a second obligation to give, netina, to give what you should give to the Kohen, to the Levi, to the Ani, to the poor person, to redeem Maaser Sheni. But that's the second level. Even if we don't do the second level, because we're lazy, or because we cannot do it because of all kinds of reasons that we will explain in a few minutes, even without netina, without giving, still, once we separated a name, that's enough. The produce is no longer tevel. And this will be very important because, as we will see today, when we're talking about individuals in the house, we don't do netina. We don't give the produce. We just do the first thing, separating and naming. That's the first thing important to know. Okay, tevel. Tevel, Chazal explained, tov, lo. Tov, good, lo. Lamed alef, no. No good. Tevel, the produce before you did the Hafrashat Terumot and Maaserot, is called tevel. And the isur of eating tevel is mita bide shamayim. If you would ask a person, what's more chamur, what's more severe, to eat not kosher meat, or to take an apple from my yard, to bring it in the house and eat it without separating terumot and maaserot. Most people, I think, will say, not kosher meat, of course. But not kosher meat is isur lav, and isur tevel is isur mitah v'deshamayim. And tevel is a very strict isur, and tevel, when it's still tevel, you cannot benefit from it, forbidden to benefit from its consumption in the broad sense of the word, meaning you cannot use tevel to burn it and to use the fire for heating or for warmth. You cannot give this tevel to a non-Jew, sell it to him or to give it to him, or you cannot use this tevel in order to give your animals food. To smell it is permitted. And one very important thing, don't leave tevel in the house. When we once, when we got, somebody gave us food and my wife was at home and I came home and I said, my wife, no, you take the water mask. I said, no, it's, I don't know what to do it. It's frightening, you do it. I said, Chava, it's easy, there's a text. You say, it's not such a big thing. No. It's not good, you deal with it. The problem is that, like, you're not supposed to leave something of tevel in your house because there's a big chance of somebody accidentally, one of the other house members, to eat it accidentally. So once you finish the shiur and you know 100% how to afish terumot and maaserot, the minute you bring home the produce, do afrashat terumot and maaserot. That's the best. Then you know you did it. If not, write a note or do something that you are sure 100% that nobody will use it accidentally. That's the first thing. Another thing, it's forbidden to plant tevel seeds. It's a whole discussion. But if you buy seeds and you want to plant them, so basically you should mafrish to water maaserot from the seeds before you plant them. Otherwise, it's gidulei tevel. It's a bit complicated, but this is the basic halakha. Questions till now?
So you're saying that if you buy seeds in the store, if you buy seeds to plant, like I'm going to do with my garden club from this week, Rabbi, we need to separate terumot and maaserot from that?
Basically, yes, especially if the seeds are edible. If the seeds are edible, for sure you should mafrish terumot and maaserot for them before you see them. And of course, afterwards, when they grow, you have to separate again. But that's for sure. But even before you plant them, if the seeds are not edible, so it's that's a discussion. That's a discussion. We say it's better to mafrish even if the seeds are not edible. But if they are edible, for sure you have to mafrish.
Does this apply to herbs and fruits and vegetables and strawberries? What does it apply to?
All plants that are plants that you eat. About herbs, I'll talk in a few minutes because it's a bit more complicated. But basically, whatever you eat.
What if you have a small little orange, those miniature oranges?
Kumquat,
The little oranges, and let's say one is ready. So how do you take a masar from one?
I'll explain to you in a minute with one lemon I just picked from my garden, and I'll do it, so we'll explain it in a minute, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Netina, who do we give it to? So we have five matanot, five presents we're supposed to give. The first one is Terumah Gdola, we give it to the Kohen. Terumah Gdola, okay. The second one is Maaseh Rishon. We give it to the Levi. The third one is Terumat Maaser, given to the Kohen. And the fourth one is either Maaser Ani, poor person tithe, Maaser of the poor person, or Maaser Sheni. We'll discuss about the last two in a minute. So every time you mafrish, you give, you say Truma Gdola, Maaser Rishon, Trumat Maaser, and depends what year we are in, Maaser Ani or Maaser Sheni. How much do we give? So Truma Gdola, we give to the Kohen. From the Torah, Truma Gdola is something, a bit. Even one little grain from a whole field, according to the Torah, is enough. One grain from a whole tree is enough. Chazal said that you're supposed to give 1 out of 40, 1 out of 50, or 1 out of 60. Depends how generous you are. But Ein Benonit, the average is 1 out of 50, meaning 2% to give to a Kohen as Truma Gdola. Today, that the Kohanim are not pure, nobody is pure. We don't have Parah Adumah, we cannot pure ourselves. Kohanim are Tmei Mitim, and they cannot eat Truma, because Truma is Kodesh, and they cannot eat it when they are Tameh. So, Chazal said today that the Kohanim cannot eat the Truma, will go back to the basic amount Mideoraita from the Torah, which is something. So today, when we separate, the Truma Gdola would be something. That's Truma Gdola to the Kohen. The second Matana is Maaser Rishon to the Levi. Maaser, Me'eser, 1 out of 10. 1 out of 10, meaning 10% of the produce, is given, supposed to be given, to the Levi Maaser Rishon. The Levi, from the 10% he got, he's supposed to give 10% from his 10% to the Kohen. What the Torah calls Maaser Min HaMaaser, or Terumat Maaser. The Levi gives 10% of what he gets, and he gives it to the Kohen. So he gives 1% of the total produce, and he's left with 9%. Today, we give the Terumat Maaser in the Levi's name, meaning we separate 10%, we say this is Maaser Rishon, and the next step is we give the Terumat Maaser in the name of the Levi. That's what we practically do everywhere. All kashrut organizations do the same thing. We don't wait to the Levi to give it, and we give it in the name of the Kohen. So the Kohen gets 1% as Terumat Maaser plus something as Terumah Gdola. And the Levi has 9% left by him. Now, there's a big difference between Truma and the rest of the Matanot. Truma Gdola and Trumat Maaser are Kodesh. Kodesh meaning you cannot eat them. The Kohen can't, nobody can eat them. The Kohen can't eat them because he's Tameh. Us, meaning not non-Kohanim, cannot eat it because it's Kodesh. And we have a big challenge what to do with this, more than 1%. Because we basically have almost nothing to do with it. And what we do with it, I'll explain in a minute. But in the house, usually what we do, we just wrap it in a plastic bag, as I'll show you in a few minutes, and double wrap it and put it in the garbage. We have nothing to do with it. Very similar to the mitzvah of chala. Truma and chala are very similar. Chala as well, it's kadosh, we cannot eat it. And the custom is or to burn it. some people do it, or to double wrap it and to put it in the garbage respectfully, again, because it's kadosh. So that's what we, generally, that's what we do with Terumah as well as individuals. After we gave Terumah Gdola, Maaser Rishon, and Terumat Maaser, we are giving Maaser Sheni or Maaser Ani. Now, let's go back a second. When do you give, we give 10% Maaser Me'eser, 10% of what's left. We gave already 10% to the Levi, so we have 90% of the produce. 10% out of 90% is 9%. So Maaser Sheni or Maaser Ani will be 9% of the produce that we're supposed to give. Maaser Ani, look here at the bottom. Maaser Sheni, my kids taught me from school that Maaser Sheni is Aveda. What's Aveda? The years Aleph, Bet, Daled, Hey, first, second, fourth, and fifth year of the Shemitah cycle are Maaser Sheni. While Gu, Gimel, Vav, third and sixth year of the Shemitah cycle is Maaser Ani. This year we entered the sixth year. So now for vegetables, it will be Maaser Ani year. About fruit, we'll discuss in a few minutes. But basically this year, Taf Shin Pei Aleph 5781, this year is a Maaser Ani year. And we give Maaser Ani. What is exactly Maaser Ani and Sheni? So Maaser Ani is very similar to Maaser Rishon for the Levi. Maaser Ani, originally what you're supposed to do, to take 9% of the produce and to give it to a poor person. Now the halacha says that the poor person has to come to me. I'm not obligated to run around once I brought it to my house. He has to come to me. But basically, I'm supposed to take 9% of my produce and to give it to poor people, which of course is easier with a farmer that has hundreds of kilos of apples, more complicated when you have two kumquats, and 9% of two kumquats is a very small amount. That's why what most people do maybe it's bidiavad. What they do is either they name it, they mafrish, but they eat it because the poor person doesn't come, or it's not worthwhile for any poor person to come to my house for half a tomato and a quarter of a lemon. Or what some people do, they think, how much money does this half a lemon of Maaser Ani, how much money is it? How much is a lemon? I don't know. 4 shekel. So half a lemon, Maaser Ani. The Maaser Ani is 50 agorot. So I put 50 agorot in the tzedakah box and give it to poor people. That's what many people do. We in Machon HaTorah V'Eretz have, I think, a much better solution, which we'll discuss in a minute, how to give this to the Maaser Ani, to the Aniim, to the poor people, without working hard. That is Maaser Ani. In the years of Maaser Sheni, so in the time of Beit HaMikdash, you were supposed to take 9% of the produce and to bring it to Yerushalayim and to eat it in Yerushalayim B'Kdusha, when you are pure, inside the walls of Yerushalayim. In the time of Beit HaMikdash, if you lived far away and it was difficult for you to bring the produce, you can redeem it on a coin, Chilul Maaser Sheni, and take this money, the coins, the money to Yerushalayim, and then buy with this money fruits and vegetables, and then to eat the meal, to eat it in Yerushalayim with the money that you bought. Now, when you do this Chilul, so you have to add a Chomesh, one-fifth, or one-fifth, it's a quarter a quarter. Chomesh is one fifth, but it's one fifth after you add it. So it's a quarter from the produce. And when we redeem Maaser Sheni today as well, when it's ours, the produce, and that's usually the situation, so we have to add a quarter of the value before we redeem it. In the time of Bet HaMikdash, the Gemara says, what happens if you have oranges that worth 200 shekels? So the Gemara says, if you redeem these 200 shekels on a pruta, which is 6 agorot about, you redeem it on a pruta, it's valid. B'diavad, it's valid even in the time of the Bet Mikdash. L'chatchila, of course, you should do the same amount of money. But b'diavad, it's valid. The Geonim said today that we don't have what to do with Maaser Sheni because it's Kadosh. We can't eat it in Yerushalayim because we're Tmeim. There's no temple, there's no Mizbeach, there are no walls. Kadosh. We have some of the walls, but not walls that are Kadosh for this. So we have nothing to do with the Maaser Sheni. So Chazal said, the Geonim said that today, lechatchila, we should redeem the produce of Maaser Sheni on a pruta, and then to add a one-fifth, and to redeem it on a pruta. That's what practically we do on Maaser Sheni. Doesn't matter how much you have. You can have two oranges, you can have 500 oranges. When you redeem them, you redeem the whole quantity on the pruta. If you have apples and oranges, and you do frasha for both, so you have to have two prutot, one for each type of produce.
What do you do with the prutot?
What do we do with the prutot? So I remember my father. Okay, I'll explain now. A pruta is 6 agorot, and we add another one-fourth on our tax. So it's about 8 agorot. We tell people 10 agorot. So you can do 10 agorot, and then the 10 agorot is kadosh. You have nothing to do with it. Not only that, but you're supposed to get rid of it. The Mishnah says to throw to Yam HaMelech, or to take what we say today is to take a hammer and to bang on the coin until you can't use it anymore. I was in one of the lectures, so somebody told me that his father, when he was young, he would take the coins to the train tracks and put the coin there before the train passed. And then the coin was destroyed. Practically what we do, it's a challenge. It's a problem because it's people don't like to break coins. I understand that. What usually we do, you take a 10 shekel coin, and then you can redeem it 100 times. Because 10 agorot is one chilul, and you do it 100 times, and only then it fills up. The problem is that you have to mark yourself, I don't know, to have this 10 shekels somewhere to make sure your wife or your husband and your kids and your parents-in-law don't take it accidentally and use it because it's kadosh. You have to make sure how many times you use it and not to use it anymore. You have to make sure before Pesach of the fourth and seventh year to do bi'ur ma'asrot and to get rid of the coin. It's a challenge. We in Bet HaOtzar, we have a good solution for that the coin of the members is in our safe in Torah Ve'Aretz Institute, and then we take care of it. We do the bi'ur, we count, we do everything. And then a person, his coin is out in our safe in Bet HaOtzar. But I'll explain about Bet HaOtzar in a few more minutes after we explain the basics. Did I answer about the coin?
Yeah, I thought you just throw it away, but I guess not.
No. You're supposed to destroy it. That if somebody will find it, the coin could not be used. The Chazal said ubar tsurato, that you can't use it.
So ultimately, okay. Ultimately, you were giving more than 10%, were you?
Like, in the time of Chazal, the taxes were about 22%.
Okay.
Because it was 2% for Truma Gdola, another 10% for Levi Kohen, and another 9%. So it's 21%. That's a lot. Meaning, if today you will tell a farmer, give me another 21% besides all the taxes you pay, he will laugh at you and give you the keys to his tractor and say, okay, you can exchange me. I cannot earn a living on 21% extra taxes. In the time of Chazal, probably these were the taxes. Meaning the taxes went to the Kohen and to the Levi, which were probably the rabbis, the teachers, and to the poor person, Maaser Ani. And Maaser Sheni going to Yerushalayim, that's a bit tough job. But these were the taxes. Today, to add them is very, very difficult, and we'll maybe say a word afterwards what the farmers do today. Okay, I'll just add that on the Shemitah year, basically you do not have to mafrish Terumot and Maaserot because it's Hefker. But if you buy Heter Mechira produce, then you're supposed to take Terumot and Maaserot without a blessing. But if you have a tree or fruit and vegetables in your garden outside and it's hefker, so you're patur from Terumot and Maaserot. But Shemitah, I don't want to talk too much because it's at least one long lecture, the details of Shemitah. So Bezrat Hashem.
Bezrat Hashem, we'll plan another shiur after Shavuot.
Definitely. Okay, we're keeping on. What should we do with the Terumah? So, Chazal said a Kohen can give it to his animal. And that's what they do, the farmers, the big kashrut organizations, that's what they do. All the Terumot of Yerushalayim go to a rabbi who is officially, legally, the animals of the biblical zoo in Yerushalayim. He owns them. He owns all the animals. And he gets the Terumah and he gives it to his animal in the biblical zoo. Meaning the 1% of the Terumah Gdola plus Terumat Maaser in Yerushalayim, 1% is a lot if you're thinking of hundreds and hundreds of kilos of produce. And they give it to animals. The safari in Ramat Gan do the same. The Beit Shemesh, they have like a small zoo of Rav Slifka, they do the same. They give it to Kohen's animal. And if you have a neighbor, which is a Kohen, and you have some vegetables that maybe he will want to eat, so you are more than welcome to give it to him. If it's oil, you can use it for lighting candles, Hanukkah candles or Shabbat candles, a Kohen. But otherwise, you have to bury or to burn it. That's what you do with the Terumah. And as I said, bury meaning put it in a double bag, wrap it, and put it in the garbage. Now, what is, I picked a lemon. Just, it's 7:30. I remembered my neighbor here allowed me. I have a lemon, which is picked half an hour ago. This lemon is what year? Is it the fifth year, last year, or the sixth year now? So the answer is not so easy. If we're talking about vegetables, so as you can see, we go according to the harvest, and Rosh Hashanah is one of Tishrei, Aleph Tishrei, meaning whatever we pick, we harvest after Rosh Hashanah is already the new year, meaning now Maaser Ani. So all the vegetables we pick after Rosh Hashanah, we have to separate Maaser Ani and not Maaser Sheni, because it's already the sixth year. If we're talking about fruit, is different. When we say Tu Bishvat Rosh Hashanah Leilanot, that means Rosh Hashanah Leilanot for this, for Maaserot. Meaning only after Tu Bishvat will become the new year for fruit. So all the fruit I picked before Tu Bishvat are still last year, meaning the fifth year. And spices, just a minute about spices. Now we see. Okay. So fruit. If I pick them before Tu Bishvat, they are still last year. Even if I pick them after Tu Bishvat, they are still considered last year's because I have to make sure the chanata, the blooming, the beginning of the ripening of the fruit, that has to be after Tu Bishvat. Only if the chanata was after Tu Bishvat, so the fruit which I will pick a few weeks later, a few months later, only that will be the new year's. But if I came a day after Tu Bishvat and I picked my fruit, a ripe fruit, so for sure it's the chanata was before Tu Bishvat, and then I mafresh last year's maaser. In our case, it will be maaser sheni and not maaser ani. Spices here are like vegetables for this. If we have legumes and grains, so we go according to Onata Maasrot, one Tishrei. Onata Maasrot is a bit more complicated. It's Maaser season. It's supposed to be Ra'ui Lemachal Al Yedei Adchak. If on Rosh Hashanah it's already, you can eat it, Bishat Adchak, it's not, you usually won't eat it, but it's ripe enough to eat it in special situations that you don't have what to eat. So in such a case, it's already the next year. But if the Maaser season was before Rosh Hashanah, meaning when Rosh Hashanah came, it wasn't ripe yet, so it will be the next year. Now, this is a bit complicated. That's why in our text, I'll just show you here. Can you see my mouse? In the text, we say, another 9% of the lower part of the produce is Maaser Sheni. And if the year requires Maaser Ani, it is Maaser Ani. Meaning, if you're not sure, you don't remember 50 or 60 fruits, vegetables, say both. Do a tnai. Say it's Maaser Sheni, and if it's supposed to be Maaser Ani, so Maaser Ani. It's only one of the two. So you can say this or this. And this is, we wrote it in the text because many people are not sure. And once you say it, you're 100% covered. So I think it's a good solution. Of course, it's better to know specifically. If you know specifically, so of course, you don't have to say it. You're saying Maaser Sheni, or if it's relevant, Maaser Ani, you say Maaser Ani. But if you're not sure, say this text and you're covered. Okay, let's keep on. Okay, it's 8:10. Okay, redeeming Maaser Sheni on Apruta. Apruta, as I said, is we use at least 10 agorot. It can be even 5 cents. It can be 2 euro cents, whatever. At least equivalent to 8 agorot, but it has to be a coin. It cannot be shtar. No.
Paper money.
No. Paper money. Thank you. Thank you. Paper. It cannot be paper money. It has to be a matbea, a coin. Okay. Now, wait, I have a question here on the chat. A bill, thank you. How do we get a copy of that language in English that you showed? I'll show it to you in a minute. Okay. Somebody asked, do you have to be Israeli grown seeds? Yes, of course. If it's not Israeli grown, it's patur mitrumot u'maaserot. So when you seed it, there's no problem. It's not tevel. After it grows in Israel, of course, so what grew from the seeds, from the overseas seeds, if the seeds came from abroad, so they are not tevel, you don't have to mafrish them. You can eat them or you can seed them. Once you planted them in the ground, when something grows, of course, you're supposed to separate the water maasrot from it. So that's Dakra that asked, and I missed that. And okay. Now, if it's okay with you, I will take my lemon. I picked the lemon at 7:30, and I'm going to mafrish the water maasrot from it live to make sure we all understand. Can you read what it says here? It's a bit small. I'll read it as well. Make sure you have a coin that is worth enough putot for several chilulim, redemptions. Members of Bet Otzar have a designated coin located at the Bet Otzar headquarters. I'm a member as well, so my coin is in the safe in Bet Otzar, so I don't have to show it. Number two, set aside a little more than 1% of each type of fruits or vegetables. Now, if you do lemon, you're supposed to take more than 1% of the flesh, meaning the flesh, the part that you eat, that you use. And you're supposed to take 1% of that and not to use the peel, because the peel, and let's go make sure it's 1%. Okay, now I have more than 1%. I'm now on the left side. If the produce is definitely tevel, no one separated from it, what ma'asot, make the following blessing before reciting the full text. I picked it half an hour ago. It's for sure tevel. I'll say bracha and please answer amen wherever you are. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם אשר קדישם מצוותיו וציוונו להפריש תרועות ומעשרות.
אמן.
Okay. Now I'm on the right side where it says number three. The full text for setting aside תרועות ומעשרות. What I am about to say. Yes, who wanted to ask a question?
Yeah, we can't see what you're doing. We see only the sheet of setting aside.
So what will I do?
Mm-hmm. You have to pin the video of the rabbi and then you'll see.
What?
You have to pin the video. I can see you and the sheet.
Okay, so somebody said.
You have to do the side by side with speaker view.
Me or the participant?
The participant.
Okay, so whoever asked, do a side by side, and then you can see my shared screen, and you can see the people, and pin me as the host, and then you will see my my picture there. Okay, I'm keeping on. So, what I'm about to say applies to each type of produce separately. If I have lemons and oranges and tomatoes, I can say everything once, and it applies to each produce separately. Of course, I have to separate 1% of each produce, but I can say the text only once. Okay. The 1% that is on the lower side of the produce I have set aside, this one, remains tevel for the time being. The rest of what I have set aside is to mark for all of the produce. This is more than 1%. This has two parts in it, virtual, of course. One small part is Truma Gdola, and all the rest will be Trumat Maaser. In order, practically, I'm cutting only once, more than 1%, because I know this will be Truma Gdola and Trumat Maaser. But the halakha says I have to set the presents one by one, by the order, and Truma Gdola is first. That's why I just said that the more than 1%, which is the small piece, is Truma Gdola for all the photos, because as we said, Truma Gdola is a bit, is something. After I named the Truma Gdola, I'm keeping on, the 1% I mentioned, and another 9% on the upper side of the photos is Maaser Rishon. As we explained, Maaser Rishon is 10%. 9% on the upper side. Some texts say on the lower side of the north, that doesn't matter. One of the sides, a specific side, and another 1% together is 10%, which is supposed to be given to the Levi. The next part, the 1% I previously set aside, this one is Trumat Maaser. So just to make it clear, because this is a bit complicated, I distinguish this small part here, a small part of this, as Truma Gdola. Then I said 10% is Maaser Rishon, 9% plus 1% is all 10% is Maaser Rishon, and I'm giving, in the Levi's name, I'm giving Maaser Mina Maaser, or Trumat Maaser, the 1% that is here, I'm giving it as Trumat Maaser. Questions till now?
Did you cut that small piece of lemon twice, or you just nicked it?
No.
Nicked it with a knife.
Once. Yeah, once. Again, this has more than 1%. 1% Truma Gdola, more than 1%. I'm keeping on. That another 9% of the lower part of the produce could be, we said upper, lower, could be north, south, east, west, that doesn't matter. It has to be two different sides. Another 9% of the lower part of the produce is Maaser Sheni Orani. What did we say? We said
Maaser Sheni, it's not Ani yet.
Rosh Hashanah is Tu Bishvat.
Right.
We are before Tu Bishvat, so we are still last year, fifth year, so it's Maaser Sheni. So another 9% of the lower part of the forest is Maaser Sheni. Okay. Now I'm keeping on. I see the clock is ticking. On the left side on the bottom, if the process is definitely subject to Maaser Sheni and is undoubtedly Tevel, recite the following blessing before redeeming the coin on a the forest on a coin. I'll say the bracha and please answer amen. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher gilshan mitzvotav etzivanu lifdot maaser sheni.
Amen.
What I have now I'm number four. What I have designated as maaser sheni plus a quarter of its value is now redeemed by transferring its sanctity to a pruta and a quarter's worth of my designated coin. This redemption applies to each type of produce in accordance to its level of obligation. Say it, but I don't want to explain it now. It's a bit difficult to explain. Again, my coin is in Beit HaOtzar headquarters, so I don't have what to worry. If the fruit is Netta Revai, it's not Netta Revai, fourth year, we have to do Lifdot Maaser Netta Revai. We're not doing it now. And number five, to dispose of the Truma, double back the 1% plus this one, the small piece that you separate and place it respectfully in the trash. And now what I have here is already everything is separated. Questions?
So the big piece that you have in your hand, I just wanna make sure I understand, that can be used or not?
Yes, this is the produce we eat. The small piece that I separated, the 1%, that we put in the garbage, respectfully. But this is what we eat, yes.
So the 9% is in that piece you're holding.
Oh, very good. I'll get to it in a minute. Yes, you're right. The 9% of Maaser Sheni was here, and I redeemed it on a coin. So now the Kedusha left it and is now on the coin.
Okay.
Of course, if I would have 10 lemons, I would have to cut only one of them, 1/10 of one lemon, and then it will be 1% of the whole produce, of course. You don't have to cut each one. A tip, if you have, five oranges, so it's good to pick as well one which is not as good, and then you can, that is the one you can use as a Terumot and Maaserot, or that's the one to cut, because sometimes, you know, you want to, you pick them on Friday and you want to use them only on Shabbat and you don't want to cut one of them. My wife is upset at me all the time. I cut the lemons and then, you know, it's not fresh after a few days. So that's something to think of. If you have a few, you can pick another one, a smaller one, to be the one to be cut. Okay, I'm keeping on.
One quick question. Are you allowed to do that? And I know with Korbanot, you have to bring the best. Are you allowed to take a piece of fruit that's not so good to use?
Oh, good question. The halakha says that in the time of the Mikdash, no. It's called Afrasha Mehara al Hayafeh, from the Ra, the bad one, and the good. You're not supposed to do it. Today, the Shulchan Aruch says that it's not eaten by Kohanim, so you can do it even lechatchila, but you have to make sure the bad part is still ra'ui lema'achal adam, meaning people can eat it. They don't like to eat it because it's not not as nice, but it's ra'uy le'ma'achal adam, people can eat it. If it's ra'uy le'ma'achal adam, it's fine, even if it's not the best quality. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, what do we do in Beit HaOtzar? We sign Mechon HaTorah Ve'aretz, people have three problems. Let's start with the third one, the coin. The coin is a big schlep and a big heavy. To make sure you have it, nobody uses it, to remember how many times, to remember to get rid of it when twice every 7 years, it's challenging. And if you're a member of Beit HaOtzar, we have a coin for you, and you can use it 20 times a day. Up to 20 times a day you can use it, and we calculate exactly how. And then you don't have to take care of the coin, it's by us. That's the first thing. Second thing is Maaser Levi, Maaser Rishon, and Maaser Ani. What we do is follows. We have a Levi, which is a tzaddik, and we work with him. And every member of Beit HaOtzar signs a contract, and this contract, he writes that his Maaser Rishon, he will always give this Levi. Specific Levi, through us, through Beit HaOtzar. Now, every member gives a loan to this Levi, a yearly loan of 40 shekels a year. After you give him 40 shekels a year, every time you pick up and say, this 9% is yours, the Levi, halachically, it's his. That's the how exactly Kinyan Chatzer, it's a bit complicated, but halachically, once you're a member, the 9% becomes his. And what he does with it, he sells it back to you. So let's say, the 9% here, I was mixed up. The 9% that are here, on this side, goes to the Levi, and he sells it back to me. How much is 9% of this lemon? 20 agorot, let's say. So he sells it back to me, and he deducts from the loan. He took from me 40 shekels. Now he needs to pay me back only 39 shekels and 80 agorot. Tomorrow I have another half a tomato. So again, 10 agorot less. In a week we have more. Until the end of the year. If at the end of the year he still owes me money, which is usually what happens with individuals that don't have a lot. So I waive the loan. I tell him, Mr. Levi, you don't have to give it back to me. This Levi is a tzaddik, and he gives the money to Mosdot of Tzedakah, Torah, v'Chesed. So this, the 40 shekel I give, goes to Tzedakah, and goes, what were the Levim in the past? The Levim were the teachers, were the rabbis. So by me giving them to Mosdot of Tzedakah and Torah v'Chesed, I fulfilled basically what the Torah wanted me to fulfill as Maaser Rishon, doing it in a very easy way, very practical way, and most important, without needing to get out of my house. If you are already a Levi, so you do not need to give it to anyone else. You have to say the text. You have to name it, but you don't have to give it to the Levi. That's why if you're a Levi or a Kohen, so by us you pay only half price. Only 40 instead of 80, because the Maaser Rishon, you don't need to give anyone else. There's a place to write it to your Maaser Levi or Kohen, then you pay half price.
How do we know that the Levi is really a Levi any more than at the beginning you talked about the Kohen as a Sofei Kohen, so we don't give it
there. We choose a Levi that has a Yichus 500 years till the Taz, the Turei Zahav. He has Mamash Megillat Yochsin, and he's what's called a Levi Meyuchas from Yemen. You don't know 100%, but he's a Levi Miyuchas, what's called in Halakha. Okay. Maaser Rishon is, Maaser Ani, we do the same thing, but we do it with a Keren Tzedakah. We give 40 shekels a year to the Keren Tzedakah, to the Tzedakah organization. And every time I have 9%, it goes directly to the Keren Tzedakah, and they sell it back. And at the end of the year, I tell them the loan stays by you. And then again, 30, 40, doesn't matter how much exactly, but a few dozens of shekelim go to aniyim, poor people. Last year, Maaser Ani, we gave 700,000 shekel. Not us. Members of Bet HaOtzar gave to us 700,000 shekel for tzedakah through Bet HaOtzar. So these are the three big advantages of members of Bet HaOtzar. And once you do it, you get a thing like this for home, Hebrew or English. And then you get a sticker here that says your subscription is until Tevet next year. And a month before, they call you and ask you if you want to become to renew your membership. This is Bet HaOtzar. Here's what somebody asked about the here, Kohen Olevi, you can see. Kohen Olevi here, you just have to put a few Kohen Olevi. Tourist, as if somebody came from the States for 2 months, he wanted to be, he didn't want to pay any shekels, so we have you for tourists. When people came in the past to Israel for 2 months. I have a monthly donation going to your organization, so I'm a member, correct? Marty Weisberg, I assume so. But if you didn't get such a thing home, the Hebrew or English, so make sure you are, because maybe you gave a donation without being a member. Could be, just make sure. And you can email them, you can ask them, you can on the English website, just send a question and I can check it with you, check it with the people.
Okay, now we need to talk about when you take this, where the trees are growing, where are the fruits and vegetables growing, where are the herbs growing? That's a whole another topic that we're all concerned about because many of us have gardens, pots in the ground, not in the ground.
Okay, so basically we are talking about Terumot and Maaserot, not Shemitah. Shemitah is different. If we are growing outdoors, so we have to do Terumot and Maaserot from the Torah, Midoraita. If we grow it indoors, I mean in the house, which is separated from the ground and from the sky, meaning in a closed mirpeset or inside the house, then we separate Terumot and Maaserot without a blessing. Why it's a machloket Rambam Raived? The Rambam says you should do Terumot Maaserot mid Rabbanan. The Ravid says it's patur. And the halakha lemaaseh is that you must be Terumot Maaserot mid Rabbanan, but without a bracha. That everything grows in the house. Could be fruits, could be vegetables, could be herbs. Everything in the house, once it's in the house, for sure it's without a bracha. If it's open mirpeset, so it's considered outside. Now we're getting to the most complicated questions, but that herbs, very practical. If you grow herbs, let's say now, outside or inside, doesn't matter. If you grow herbs or every plant that you eat the leaves, so it's chayav Terumot Maaserot, just like every other vegetable. Could be parsley, could be coriander, could be all leaves that are eaten, you are subject to Terumot Maaserot. Somebody asked here, what if you have an upper mirpeset over your mirpeset where you are growing plants? Again, if you have, from what I said, if it's not or if neshamayim, there's no direct, if you go up, you don't go to the sky. It's closed, so it's considered inside the house. Now, mint in a minute. Mint is the most difficult. So if you have leaves that are edible and people eat them, you're supposed to take Terumot and Maaserot. If they are not eaten, so that is a machloket. If, well, I'll explain in a minute exactly. If you have things that are used for tea, which many people do, now, if you put them in tea, but people eat them as well, but you decided to put them for tea, so the mean, the this kind is called, is edible, people eat it. So you're chayab Terumot and Maaserot. But if everybody in the world puts them in the tea and afterwards throws them out, so most poskim say you're patur from Terumot and Maaserot, because nobody eats these leaves. You use only the aroma that comes out from them, only the essence. You're patur from Terumot and Maaserot. Rav Mordechai Eliyahu, which is the chief rabbi, Rishon LeZion, he was machmir on this. So that's why many poskim say, recommend the mafrish without a bracha, whatever goes for whatever people use as tea. But I said the basic halacha is patur. But if you have, let's say, mint, nana, so that some people eat. Some people use it in salads. So most people use it only for tea, but some people use it for salad. So for mint, I would say it's more, it's preferable to mafrish Terumot and Maaserot. Again, without a bracha, but the mafrish. If you have other things that are not edible at all, only use them for tea. So then I said most poskim say you don't have to. And Rav Eliyahu Machmir, so we think, recommend to mafrish without a bracha, but it's only a hidum or chumra. It's not a meikar adin, and doesn't matter if you're inside or outside. Even if it's in the house, if the species is chayav Terumot and Maaserot, so you're supposed to mafrish Terumot and Maaserot. Questions on herbs, because it's a bit complicated.
So you're saying if the herb is in a pot and the pot is sitting on a merpeset and the merpeset has sunlight, you do Terumot and Maaserot. It has nothing to do with being in the ground.
It has to be...
What if it's sitting on a ledge that has nothing to do with the ground?
Again, if it's disconnected from the ground and from the sky, it's considered bituch habayit.
What if it's disconnected from the ground, but there is sky?
So that is basically is like outside.
Okay.
For Shemitah, it can be a bit different, but we're not talking about Shemitah now. Okay.
All those pots of herbs that I thought I was patur, I am not, because they're outside under the sky.
You are zoiche to have Terumot and Maaserot. Yes. Again, what are you growing? What kinds of plants? If it's parsley, coriander, so it's edible.
Yes, parsley, rosemary, and mint and nana.
And mint. So again, mint is more tricky, as I said.
Okay.
But yes, more people about herbs, because this is very important. Now, herbs is Carol is right, it's difficult because you pick 4 leaves, 5 leaves, 10 leaves to put in your salad, and then to think to what the Maaserot for 5 leaves, what I have to cut of more than 1% of have like a quarter of a leaf. Once you learn how to do this, it takes you 60 seconds. Exactly. From the time you started till the time you finished. Exactly 60 seconds, especially if you have already a coin by us, then you don't have to take care of the coin. It's very quick. It's very fast. Of course, you have to do it a few times in order to understand, etc., what you say and how to do it, but once you do it a few times, it's very, very important. Okay. We are, well, let's just do quick what I skipped. If you live in Yerushalayim, very practical, in the old city, or between the walls of a Beit Sheni, you're supposed to wet the produce before you do a Afrashat Terumot and Maaserot, because you can't redeem Maaser Sheni in the ancient Yerushalayim. So you have to wet the produce and then touch it, then becomes Tameh, and only then you can mafrish Mechalel Maaser Sheni, because you can Mechalel Maaser Sheni Tameh, but not Mechalel Maaser Sheni when it's Tahor. So if you live in Yerushalayim, the ancient, the Ir Atika, so it's very practical. Shabbat, you cannot do Terumot and Maaserot. It's Nechshav Kemetaken, looks like fixing, and you cannot mafrish Terumot and Maaserot on Shabbat. If you do hydroponics, you do without a blessing, also machloket, but practically you mafrish without a blessing. If you make juice, you should separate Terumot and Maaserot before squeezing. All kinds of juice, besides wine and grape juice, both of them you should separate after squeezing. If it's owned by a non-Jew, you are patur from Terumot and Maaserot. If you buy from an Arab and you show he's the one that he growed it, or a different Arab grew it, so you're patur from Terumot and Maaserot. If it grew by a Jew, but you buy in a grocery that the Arab is in charge there, so of course it's chayav b'Terumot Maaserot. But if it's the goy, he was the one he was the owner of the produce, so it's patur. Ownerless produce hefker, this is very practical. What happens if you have all kinds of trees or sometimes vegetables that the city planted? Can I take the fruit? That's one thing. And that's not so much for us. That's for Gezel or not Gezel. But let's say the city allows to take it. Do I need to mafrish Terumot and Maaserot? The question is, are the fruit hefker? If the city or the yeshuv, the municipality, doesn't matter, they don't have a problem of somebody coming, even with a truck, and taking all the fruit and vegetables, taking them all down, the fruit, if they don't have a problem, so it's hefker. If it's hefker, you're patur Terumot and Maaserot. Even if you took a lot, doesn't matter. You're patur from Terumot and Maaserot. If it's not hefker, but still you're allowed to take, let's say it's a yeshuv that allows only the people in the yeshuv to take, but he doesn't want people from outside the yeshuv. He doesn't want Arabs to come from somewhere and Palestinians to come and to take all the harvest all the food. Then it's not hefker, and then once you bring it in the house, you chayav b'Terumot and Maaserot. But if it's hefker, if it's and usually I think in most cities they plant these trees, they don't care if people come and take the food, so it's hefker. But it's better to make sure every city to ask the municipality. That's the basic guidelines. Of course, if you have in your, I don't know, you have in your, you're in an apartment building and you have like a small yard. So that's, even though theoretically every person can come in and take the food, but you don't want it. You want it to be for the people in the building, even if you don't have a fence or something. And then, of course, it's not hefker. Is there a shiur such as, just a second, kabitza or kazait below which you don't mafrish? No, there's no shiur. If you eat achilat arai, if you're outside and you eat achilat arai, so you don't have to mafrish. I think maybe that's what you meant. And this is here, this. If you, here the second. If you in a chatzer she'ena mishtameret, a place which is not fenced, that it's not fenced so people can go in and out. So snacking is permitted, achilat arai is permitted. You can take one, two, three and eat them. But this not everybody knows. If it's a private courtyard or garden, you have a courtyard, but it's private, it's closed with a fence, even if it's not locked, but it's closed with a fence, this is called chatzera mishtameret, and here you can eat only one at a time. You cannot eat achilat arai, even if you have grapes. You can take only one and eat, and then to take the second one and eat. Only if it's chatzer she'ena mishtameret, with no fence, then you can take a bunch of grapes to hold them and to eat them and to eat them. This is a big difference that not everybody knows. I hope I answered whoever asked. This is snacking in the garden or field. If it's snacking is permitted, once you brought it inside the house, you pass through the door of your house, then it's chayav b'terumot and maaserot. Before that, snacking is permitted. Of course, achilat keva is not allowed even outside. Meaning, if you have a whole meal of fruits and vegetables outside, so that's assumed even outside. Yes.
If it's say chatzer hamishtameret, but before picking anything from the tree, I open up the gate. Does that change anything, or is it still mishtameret?
No, it's still mishtameret.
Okay.
Quick question. If I bought lettuce, a head of lettuce, and I'm not sure who grew it, how would I just take a leaf or part of the leaf and do maaserot and terumot?
Thank you very much. Very good question. If I get it from someone which is a safek, I don't know if somebody separated or not, or I bought in a place that doesn't, a grocery that doesn't have a kosher certificate. Oh, I bought it somewhere, somebody gave it to me, a not religious person, I don't know if they rely on him. In all these cases, you do a frashat terumot and maaserot exactly as we explained, just you don't say the blessing. The brachot you do not say, all the rest you do as usual. If it's a safek, you do everything, you just don't say the brachot because of safek brachot lakim.
What if it's not a safek? I have a neighbor with a garden. Every once in a while, he gives me a bag of tomatoes, pears, peaches, whatever. So I would do the hafrasha and say the bracha because I know he didn't.
Okay. Correct. Yes.
Does that mean that you could buy from a booth in the shuk that does not have a te'udah and then just go home and do a hafrasha?
If you're talking, okay, I'll answer halachically and then a bit more. Halachically, if you buy vegetables, you can buy it and then mafrish terumot maaserot in your house, misafek, because maybe somebody separated terumot maaserot. Maybe in the warehouse, maybe in the shuk ha-sitonai, maybe it's from Tnuva and they did, you don't know. So you should do misafek. But fruit, there's a problem of orla, and it's a much bigger problem. So we think in Mechol HaTorah V'Eretz that fruit you should not buy. Even vegetables, I think it's better to buy only in places that have a Hechsher certificate, because why does this grocery store has a Hechsher certificate? Because he knows religious people would buy if it has a Hechsher certificate. By us buying in a place with no Hechsher certificate, so we are helping this store to stay without a certificate. If we would go there every week and ask, you have a certificate? He says, no. Okay, so I'll go somewhere else. Every week, and 5-6 other people will do it as well. So he will tell him, hey, you know, I'll pay 300 shekel a month for a Hechsher certificate, and I'll have more clients. So can I say it's assumed to buy in such a place? No. Is it preferable? I think it's better not to, But I can't say it's an issur. So if you have a place that you there's no, you don't have a different, you don't have a other place, or this vegetable that you look for is only in this specific store, so yes, you can be making it. Somebody asked, how reliable are the big supermarkets? Very good question. Basically, I think today it's reliable. They all have kashrut of Rabbanuyot, and many of them have a badatzi, nehadrin. Basically, I think you can rely on the big supermarkets, on the Hesher certificate. If it's especially if it's a Rabbanut nehadrin or a badatz, I'm sure there's no problem. If it's Rabbanut not mehadrin, again, each person, does he eat only mehadrin or it's not always mehadrin? If he eats only mehadrin, so when he buys in a not mehadrin shop, so maybe he should mafrish again at home to want masot. For Orla, there's no, even a kosher Rabbanut for Orla is enough. So even a fruit he can buy, what masot is more complicated. So if you keep only mehadrin, so at this store, you know, it's not mehadrin, so maybe it's relative of fresh at home again. But again, the general psak is that you can rely on the Teudot Rabbanut. They're reliable, you know, serious rabbis. It's all, especially big supermarkets, they usually come from the big warehouses. It's not a big problem. The more challenging is the small groceries that there you really have to make sure the certificate is there, and the mashgiach knows what he's doing, because there it's more complicated. Okay, there are other things. Taking Terumot Maaserot ahead of time, if somebody, let's say, has a not religious family and is afraid they will pick without mafrish Terumot Maaserot and eating, so there is a way to pick in a weekly amount in advance and to say a special text. This is complicated because you have to have more than 1% of the produce that they will, everybody, all the family members will pick. And you have to make sure the 1% that you pick is stored somewhere and it's not in the garbage and it's not valid according to all schemes. So we don't recommend it in a regular situation, but there is such a possibility. Taking Rodmas as a guest, said let's skip it. Export and import, less relevant for us. Shmita, Bezrat Hashem, when Shmita comes. This is our website. If somebody wants to take a picture or something, I want to show you. Let's see if it works. Can you see the website now?
No.
Yes.
Yes, no? Oh, wait. This is our website. Can you see it? Carol? Mitzvot at Luyot Baretz, you see it?
Yes, we could see it, okay. Yes.
So here, our services on the top. Bet HaOtzar Fund for Terumot Maaserot. And then you have your everything, how to subscribe. You have the text. You can download this as a PDF. Down here, download as a PDF. And then you can even if you're not a member, you can use our text and put it on your fridge. And if you're a member, once you subscribe and become a member, they will send you this as a magnet. Then you can use it to put it on your fridge. Any more questions?
I'd like to ask you again the issue with the seeds. What if you take the seeds from something you harvest in your garden and you did Terumot Maaserot and then you want to replant them? Do you need to?
If you took Terumot Maaserot, so these seeds are not tevel anymore. then you are, you can see them. Just, of course, when they grow, once it grows, you have to mafrish again. But from the seeds that were taken from, they're not tevel anymore.
Okay. When you take Terumot and Maaserot from seeds that you buy in the store, you have to make a beracha?
And no, because there's a machloket about it. There is a machloket about seeds. If the seeds are not edible, there's a machloket about it. If the seeds are edible, then no, it's better not to say a beracha.
No, Aaron, the coin stays in the vault, right?
No, the coin stays in the vault, yes. That was the question. It's a 10 shekel coin, I saw it. Thousands of 10 shekel coins. It's not such a big, you know. It's there in the vault, named, etc., numbered.
So what do you do if you've been doing Maaserot, you have a coin, and now I'm going to join? What do I do with the coin I have?
So after you join and everything is finalized, you need to destroy the coin.
So I can give it to my grandchildren to destroy.
Yes, but to make sure they destroy it. I remember as a kid with the hammer my father gave me on Erev Pesach, and you know it took me a few good minutes until the coin was not useful anymore. But yes.
I was told that you can take the coin and substitute it for a certain amount of sugar and then pour the sugar down the drain. Is that correct? Is that right?
Rav Mordechai Eliyahu says you can do such a thing, and not everyone agree with him. He says you can take like 3 spoons full of sugar and redeem the coin, the kedusha from the coin to the sugar, and then put the sugar in your sink. Yes. Yes, easy. You know, Mordechai Eliyahu says that I can't say you can't do it, but I prefer destroying the coin. But yes, definitely you can do such a thing. Yes. And many rabbis even suggested lechatchila. I think it's better to, you know, twice every 7 years to really fulfill the mitzvah biur maasrot by destroying the coin, especially if it's a 10 agorot coin, but you don't have to. And also what you can do, Baal Tashrit, what you can do is take the 10 shekel coin and redeem it, the kedusha, to a 10 agorot coin, and then the 10 agorot coin to destroy. Carol, that's for your grandchildren. If you're afraid of that Baal Tashrit, etc., you can do that. Whoever's afraid from Baal Tashrit can do what Rav Mordechai Eliyahu says, and to redeem the kedusha on sugar, 3 cups, 3 spoons of sugar, and then to drain them in the sink.
Is there a special text that you say to redeem it to sugar?
And just the kedusha is redeemed on the sugar.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
I'll just add, whoever wants to ask further questions, I write in the Torah tidbits. I don't know if you get it, if you know, but the OU produces a Torah tidbits every week, and I write there a weekly column. And you're welcome to send me questions on our email, by email on our website, to call. We have I'm not in the office most of the time, but you can leave a message, I'll get back to you. Any question you have, Terumot and Maaserot, Orla, Kilaim, Shmita, soon, I'll be more than happy to answer.
This all started because I had some questions and had Rabbi Bloom's phone number and called him. And then he's explaining, and I was thinking how many people have gardens or are growing and would love to learn it as well. So I opened up my questions to everybody else. So thank you, Rabbi Bloom. It was great.
Thank you, Carol.
Thank you to Carol.
Thank you, Carol, for opening it up.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.